Gabe Wilander.
Wilander wins and we're tied at 1-1.
I get the biggest kick out of pulling a practical joke or telling something funny and people not getting it. Yeah. That's the best part when they don't get it right away.
Yeah. He's sort of a prankster. I mean, people think he's a serious guy, but you know, the guy loves to laugh and he loves telling jokes. He's a little crude at times. And
he's almost as driven to be a practical joker. He gets as much a kick out of that as he gets out of anything else. If he can make you uncomfortable with some kind of a practical joke, which he's gonna get a kick out of, you may not even think is funny, but which he's gonna think is funny, I mean, that's gonna make his day.
And if you're around him for a short period of time, it's funny. If you're around for a long period of time, it ceases being funny. But as long as he thinks it's funny, that's what counts.
Don't listen to him. Any time between the 18th and 22nd is good.
See what I have to put up with?
Okay, let's see.
What can we do?
Yeah, on camera, assault and battery.
What's wrong with that?
Phenomenal practical joker. And he had a friend of his who was a businessman in Connecticut who had just gotten delivered, brand new big Mercedes, couldn't get him yet. First guy to get it, was beautiful. This guy lived and dreamed and loved his car, his brand new car. And they went out and met in a restaurant at night in Greenwich. And Yvonne had a buddy who worked for the Mercedes dealer. And he had them come and remove the doors off that guy's car and put crushed doors back on the car. And that guy walked out of that restaurant and saw that car. And never forget that face. It was one of the best moments of all time.
Wembley indoors, and it was pouring outside. I said, Rich, let's get something straight before the match. I said to him, if I come up to the chair and say it's really sunny outside, think of every curse word I would like to tell you, and that's what it really means. So sure enough, I get a couple bad calls. I go, Rich, how did you see that? It was in. I said, you know, it's so sunny outside. he couldn't do anything.
Up next, Lendl redefines the game of tennis.
But Yvonne, I just remembered, was the first guy that really put in a lot of hard work and talked about it, you know, and really sort of changed the sport in that way.
I certainly think Lendl was one of the first ones to set the bar as far as fitness. You know, I talked to Jimmy about it, and he said, I never went to a gym in my life, you know, I just played tennis.
I think he was the first player that really took fitness seriously. He took his diet seriously. He was one of the first guys who really hit the ball hard, and I think he sort of changed the sport.
From that point forward, the psychological edge that he had over the rest of the players was enormous. I mean, guys would walk out, many of them would walk out defeated before they even got on the court, because every other player knew that when they went out to play him, they were for sure not going to outlast him.
It just evolved into the sport of where you need to hit the ball hard, you need to be athletic, you need to be able to do everything on the tennis court.
He changed the modern game. He brought fitness and power to the game.
I've interviewed junior players who want to become great tennis players, and yes, they want to win Wimbledon, but they don't love and want the work that it's going to take to win Wimbledon. The work is maybe worth it, but they don't love the work. He loved the work.
If I'm going to play, I'm going to play properly. I'm not going to play only half-ass. I'm going to play full out, and I'm going to be able to play at decent level, which is acceptable to me. In order to do that, I have to be fit.
All right, we're back now, tied at 1. JP Peterson along with Jimmy Arias. Lendl now serving. Jimmy, you played Yvonne Lendl many times. Was that something going through your mind, that he was more fit than you?
I didn't think he was more fit than me necessarily. I just thought he hit a bigger serve than I. We had similar games, but he served bigger, covered the court beautifully, and was somewhat intimidating. He didn't even let you warm up your volley when you played Lendl. He tried to tag you during the warm-up. And to him, by the way, it was a big joke. I mean, we played a match one time where I won the first game of the match. I held serve, and he throws his racket down in his bag, and I looked over at him on the changeover and said, what, did you think you were going to win Love and Love? And he said, yes, I did.
Love 30 now.
Team 30.
15-30, another classic long rally from these two.
Lendl keeps finding himself down love 30. First two service games, but then has come up with some big serves and some big shots when he's needed it so far. What's amazing about this is he didn't step onto a court for 15 years or so and hit any tennis balls. You would think it would take you a long time to get any type of feel back. So the level he's playing at is incredible, considering that.
No ad scoring, Lendl, for the game.
Deuce, game point, receiver's choice.
These two always good friends, Jimmy?
I mean, they were rivals, obviously, in the 80s. But I think they got along.
There you go. Lendl leads 2-1 with a big serve.
I think Yvonne found it extremely difficult to retire because the retirement was not in the means of his choosing. It was largely due to an injury.
Truly ended his tennis career. He would have pain and stiffness and the inability to move. Well, obviously the game of tennis is about movement. You can't move, you can't play.
My back was so bad that I wasn't finishing matches, and even if I did, I couldn't play the next day. I had more retirements in last season than I had probably over the entire career. And that's just not the way to play. I really couldn't play.
He went through tremendous physical pain and a lot of mental anguish.
I wouldn't have mind playing another year or two because I enjoy that. I mean, I wasn't winning as much as I would like to, but I did enjoy playing. There was absolutely no pressure by then.
You know, for his career, what he's done, to play again with his back trouble, it's not a lot of fun, but it sounds like his back's better. He's trimmed down a little bit, and I'm sure he's enjoying it. He's enjoying the process. He's enjoying working hard.
I mean, seriously, ask you a question. Jerry said you lost 30 pounds.
Yes.
Is that right?
Yeah.
He's 40 pounds less than he was when I think he first got the notion that maybe he could pick up a tennis racket and play one competitive match.
Well, again, if anybody can do it, he's the guy that can make that kind of transition at 50 years old.
I have biked a lot in the past. I have not biked in a while now, but I have added rollerblading. I do enjoy that very much.
And what he's done at age 50 to take that kind of focus that he had for so long and still show that he's got that kind of focus and to get in that kind of shape and work at it the way that he has, I think it's unbelievable.
Coming up, Yvonne's equipment edge.
We made Pete Sampras's rackets back then. We made Boris Becker's rackets. So I would take Becker's rackets and Sampras's rackets and play against Yvonne with those so that in practice he was used to how the ball came off those rackets.